beans.
Do you read the Farmer's Almanac? You know,
I did a couple times.
It was pretty accurate. It was pretty accurate. It was pretty.
I was going to ask you, do you think it's accurate?
We now have Google.
Okay, so that's a little bit better than
okay. I think they got to work on their forecasting.
I know, a little bit better.
Well, you know, I read something. There was like they're like 80 between 84% and 86% accuracy.
They are. They were actually mm-hmm. very accurate. They are. When you check them, they're very
accurate. Hindsight's 2020. But right. they're predicting it in advance, so give them credit.
Well, right. We actually, a lot of our, well, not a lot, I should say, a couple of our FarmBox customers work at GPL, and so one mm-hmm. of them is in, kind of knows the weather, and so I'd say, hey, how's it look for the year? And he goes, not good. So I was like, okay, not good. And he was right. Not
Plan
good.
Appropriately.
Yep, so it was not good.
He okay. came by yesterday and he says, are we done? He said, yep, right. Rain's done. So
oh,
I was
like, geez.
Now, but, being a farmer, you were talking about time. It's a heavy time commitment. It's not like you can just, oh, we're going to go out for 14 days on an Alaskan cruise. You can't just get up and go do that.
No, it's a lifestyle.
You got to love what you do. Mm-hmm.
But we have done things. I mean, we did tour.
I mean, we traveled the world.
We traveled the world. We made a film, a small film called Homegrown Revolution, about 15 minutes.
It's on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And generally, check it was created out. Because Dad got really tired of doing presentations and kind of saying the same thing as an intro. Right. He was like, just help me out here, kid. So I was the techie, so I made this little film.
And it debuted at UCLA at Peter Sellers' class.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay. In 2017.
And it was leading
2007.
I think it was leading to a Michael Pollan presentation,
yeah.
right?
Yeah. Michael Pollan was
okay,
yes.
yeah, he travels the world and shows there. I watch his stuff like in Egypt and Africa and those countries.
Yeah, and then so Dad, after the presentation, I just threw it up on YouTube, and next thing I know,
look at a rousing ovation. Yeah. It's 9 o'clock at night, and UCLA students are falling asleep. No, so they got a rousing reply to it. So
and
that
then
was nice.
And then I got a phone call from a film festival, and they're like, "We want to premiere your film at a film festival." I'm like, "I don't have a film." And they're like,
"The one on YouTube."
I said, "It's not a film." And they're like, "It is. We're putting it in." So like a short that film. Led to one thing to another. So I brought it up because we did get to travel to India
for education,
Italy. Okay. Greece,
New Zealand,
right.
and throughout the U.S. To do presentations. Dad was whenever we put on the internet that we were going here with this film,
people would show up
and pack the places, and he would do presentations. Yeah.
But we have incredible. 2 weeks at That's a time great. Before the place falls
apart.
Yeah,
so it's like 2 weeks. Uh-huh. But our time is not so much farming because you know when you're talking about your schedule, we're kind of growing into other things like the classes and the workshops. So I'll help with the farm boxes, but. You know, I think
managing the website.
Managing the website.
Social media.
It's not only just farming that's happening. There's something greater. It's emails and
podcasts.
Right.
Well, and also the side jobs we mentioned is because we have dreams and plans.
Sure.
And it's kind of like growing the business and making it more.
More
Dad truly believed he could change the world.
Okay.
So, and he did.
Starts with an idea.
And he did. And he has a lot of dreams and plans, and we're hoping to put those into progress and take what we've learned and what we've given and give it back to the community as Dad always wanted to do. So kind of all.
So efforts. Not only are we growing food, but we're growing community and educating people too. Right. So, I mean, people email us all the time, you know, your family inspired me to do, you know, grow this and that. And so, yeah,
I wish I farmed a lot more, but I'm handling a lot of administrative
work
now.
Jordan's a techie now, so she's.
Well, we call tech support. It's Jordan. So one of the things we did after Dad died was we wanted to tell our story, so we launched a podcast last Father's Day. So we currently have
Almost 60 episodes and 300,000 downloads.
Okay, why don't you go ahead and plug that? What's the name of your?
Urban Homestead Radio.
it's on the website.
iTunes, it's on iTunes. Yeah. And what's the other one?
I think we were getting it on Spotify, but I'm
not sure. There's like 16 platforms.
UrbanHomestead.org/podcast.
If you want to see the episodes, yeah.
Okay, I'm definitely going to start.
It's very informal. It's just like we're just telling us, you know, like what happens in the day.
Yeah.
It's not structured. And it's
then we sometimes interview people.
Okay.
Yeah. Every other one.
Yeah.
It's getting our story told, and it's like all that stuff in our head.
Right. Well, with the advent of social media and, you know, stations like Netflix and Hulu that are showing these documentaries, you know, people are becoming more aware of urban farming and the benefits they can have from that. You know, where do you see, you know, your farm going in the future? Do you feel that people are seeing what you're doing, like on these platforms and growing with that?
Yeah, definitely. One of the things we were proud of is and why urban farming is so important is 80% of world's population live in cities. So even though we would like more acreages, you know, mm-hmm. just like go out in the country, it's not possible for everybody. People sure. are in apartments, people are in, you know, cities and stuff like that. Right. So taking farming to an urban level is
it empowers more people.
So they think, oh, I can't do it, but just grow something. So actually the Urban Land Institute published a book and of what cities would look like in 2050. And they had our house mm-hmm. as
a model of a
residence right. in a city. So we just say, you know, not everybody can do what maybe to the extent of what we're doing, because we're a family and it's sure. full time.
You're dedicated
right.
to it. Right.
But it's, if you can't grow something, support somebody who does grow something. So go to a farmer's market. Okay. Those are definitely around now. So, mm-hmm. and meet the farmer that's growing your food and put a face to it. So if you can't, you know, grow herbs on your patio, or you just don't have the time, go support somebody who does.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And get to know them, you know, the trials they go through. Mm-hmm. It's right. not just, you know, food doesn't just magically appear mm-hmm.
right.
in the supermarkets. There is people behind mm-hmm. it, even to the point of, you know, bringing in social justice of mm-hmm. how are the people treated that are picking your food.
Right.
You know,
equal pay yeah, or just, good pay for them.
It and doesn't, you know, this cheap
the
food
chemicals are around.
Does not come cheap.
Right, right.
Yeah, to a lot of other people.
I think that some people, you know, mm-hmm. they're building walls and they don't realize these people that are on the other side of the walls are the ones mm-hmm. that are picking mm-hmm. your food.
Those families, you know. Those families being impacted. And so right, people can't exactly. even feed their families.
They said right. a lot of, NPR came out, was they said a lot of food's going to waste because people aren't be able to pick it, so.
Yeah,
and also the farmers getting older,
mm-hmm.
and it is a tough. Unfortunately for us, we grew up with it. We had our dad and his dad and his dad before him had a green thumb, so it came naturally to us.
Green jeans,
literally and figuratively. So that's what we do now. Right. For other people, it's for people coming into it, it's overwhelming, and so we try to. They say that simplify right. things. You yeah. can pull us up on Google Maps.
We demystify it too, yeah. as well. Just when people walk in and they mm-hmm. see, and when we do our classes, particularly like things with chickens, I feel a lot when I give a class about chickens. People come in and they have this like
right.
kind of completely freaked
overload.
Out view, and it's like you just like break it down. It's like, and they're like, oh wow, I can mm-hmm. do this.
Right.
It's like, yes,
or
you
they
can.
Can't,
or they decide. And I've actually been very proud of people walking away from my classes deciding. Uh-huh. Not to put chickens in the backyard, but to support a local farmer, because there is a backlash mm-hmm. of people doing things wrong. And it has happened with the whole chicken, as you okay. said, bees as well.
Yeah. Right.
People mishandling things. And mm-hmm. I've seen the ugly side of people having chickens in the backyard. So right. I'll sit there and I'll lay out all the facts and say,
mm-hmm. good and bad.
Good and bad. I won't sugarcoat it. I won't say, get chickens, they're wonderful. I'll right. say, there's this that happens.
right.
And one guy, he says, after taking a class, I made the conscious decision to say, I don't think it's for me. I don't think I can put the effort I have
and right. the time.
But let me buy your eggs or my neighbor's eggs. And right. so it was like, great. He made that effort. It's not all sugar-coated. And sometimes mm-hmm. that happens mm-hmm. in, like, trends. And there is an urban farming trend and the bee trend. And it's
right.
all...
Chicken trend.
And there's yeah. a chicken trend. Right. And people have been dumping off chickens because they can't handle them. And that wow, upsets yeah. me.
Well, yeah, also, they have to realize is it takes a chunk out of their life. Mm-hmm. The chickens need to be put up at night. They can't right. see at night. They're
no.
their dinner.
They'll dinner on the bait for everything yeah. out there.
Right. Well, I mean, right, like, here in Los Angeles, there are certain rules. That you can only have a certain amount yes. of chickens. And, you know, like one rooster for every three hens,
mm-hmm.
you know, that kind of other things like that. How do people get around that? Can they get permits for that kind of thing? Or
a lot of cities have been changing the rules. Pasadena recently mm-hmm. changed the rules. And I do think Pasadena has one of the best rules out there because they're really trying to not have so much issues. Sometimes
no roosters.
Yeah, no roosters, which is uh-huh. that's what causes a lot of the trouble.
Well, how do you get eggs with no roosters?
Well, eggs, which hen will lay eggs without a rooster.
Oh, is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's not
I'm a city person. Yeah.
It's not a pregnancy, it's an ovulation. So.
All right, right.
They're unfertile.
Well, I just
eggs.
Go to the store. Yeah. I don't know anything about that.
So the rooster makes the eggs able to hatch.
Right, right.
A hen will lay eggs and
no matter what.
And nothing what. And okay. she'll sit on them and they'll just rot.
Okay.
That's a good
picture. I feel stupid.
Hey, no, that's
one of the most common questions. I don't mm-hmm. know. I'm used to that. It's
right. I mean, because, you know, that's how, you know.
Babies are made.
Right. You know,
yeah. Okay, so end the show.
Keep it friendly. Keep it
so
friendly.
So you can just have
about farming.
Right. You can have with the ducks and you can with chickens. You can have
okay.
just all females, and that makes it a lot easier. But how people mm-hmm. worked with the city, city changed the laws. The people who petitioned the city of Pasadena used us as a case study. And I've given some emails to some people. It's generally be a good neighbor and be responsible. Don't.
For your animals.
Be responsible. Don't put 100 chickens make the decision in our, yeah. to, right, yeah. you know, have the right situation right. set up. And I
like
do
more
agree
of a
with
pet
that.
Than mm-hmm. a business if you're turning your.
Because it does mm-hmm. not. Having chickens does not mean your bills would go down.
Right.
There's no such thing as free eggs.
There's yeah. no such thing as free eggs. People are like, oh, if right. I get a chicken in my backyard, it's just going to fluff out eggs. It's like, right. let's talk
so
about
much,
this then. Organic feed.
Right, right.
And now, after 4 years, they don't lay as much. So
what are you
going to
do? Are you
going
to kill
yeah,
the old chicken?
I was gonna, what do you do with your animals?
We
that,
let them, we
the
let them
their...
live out their lives. They tend to not, like the best egg layers don't live past like five, pretty much. They as soon as they start decreasing in egg production. However, mm-hmm. just because I love my animals so much, I've had them live up to over 10 years.
Oh, wow.
And everybody's like, how old is that chicken? 12.
Right.
She's not laying anymore. Nope. Yeah.
She's costing you a small fortune.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. But her name is Lucy. So we don't kill our animals. We let them live out their lives and pass away peacefully. It can be a okay. problem if space. If you were in it for the money. Uh-huh. That would be a problem. But I'm in it for the
lifestyle.
The lifestyle. The lifestyle, the respect of the animals, treating the animals as living things that deserve respect.
Okay.
And my way of teaching this is I'll tell people, okay, so you want to have chickens, you don't want to kill them as they mm-hmm. age. What would you do? See how many chickens you can fit in your backyard in a good space that you laid out
right.
and divide it in half.
Mm-hmm.
Get five the first year. Let's say you can fit 10. Get five that first year.
Right.
Wait 2 to 3 years and get another five. And what happens is this nice egg-laying chickens, as they mature, mm-hmm. they're laying a lot of eggs. And as they start to go down, you get the new batch. And
okay.
so you kind of have this
a continuous,
continuous
flow.
So it'll like get up to 10, then it kind of goes mm-hmm. down. So if you do it every 2 years, you have a continuous flow of eggs.
Okay.
And you have the old chickens that you can still take care
right.
of. And that's kind of, it has worked for us in that way.
Or if you're so inclined.
You
can
slaughter them. Some people yeah. just, all I ask is do it to respect. That's it.
Right, right, right.
I'm the kind of person who just says, if you're going to eat something, know where your food is and give it the respect it needs.
Yeah, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Makes perfect sense. Yes. So, with your ducks, what do you get? Do you duck eggs? Is that
duck
what
eggs?
You
yes,
for?
Duck eggs. They are a high demand specialty item, and it's we can get a costly price for them.
Okay.
And that they're the cash crop because duck eggs are they're higher in egg white, and they mm-hmm. have an alkalining effect on the body. So.
Okay.
Chicken dietary, eggs can make yeah. your body acid. And, you know, when mm-hmm. you have, like, cancer or you're trying to rebalance your body, you want to de-acidify your body.
Right.
So there is diets based around removing chicken eggs and putting duck eggs into your body. And it,
okay.
like, it really can
make
throw
a
lot of the stuff in your body out of back
into where,
you know,
it, needs
where it needs to be.
Well, and when you start on duck eggs, was it? Person was allergic. Their kid was allergic
yeah.
to chicken eggs.
Uh-huh.
If you can, if you're allergic to chicken eggs, you can eat duck eggs. It's a completely different makeup.
Okay.
And you can, if you bake with them, everything's richer and loftier. So, like in France, they say mm-hmm. like the bakers only bake with duck eggs.
With duck eggs.
So uh-huh. you make it, and people think, "Oh, you're a great chef." And it's like, "Yeah, it's great. It's the duck eggs."
Uh-huh.
But those are cash crop. We have a pretty high demand for duck eggs. We can't keep them in stock, and the ducks do tend to be easier in. They don't age as fast as the chickens, so they'll, like, lay a lot more.
Sure.
They lay our ducks are land ducks. Mm-hmm. I want to clarify they are land ducks. They're not water-based ducks.
Okay.
So they live entirely on land. We don't deprive mm-hmm. them of water. These are people. They, people don't realize those
right.
are such a classification
right.
as land ducks that like to live on land. They don't lay, like water.
They don't look like Affleck.
Yeah.
Right.
And so like I said, with the choices we make in animals is not depriving an animal of what it needs to be happy. So
okay.
we chose the land ducks, and they lay, each duck would lay close to 300 eggs a year.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot
at its
of
peak.
Eggs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you cook those eggs the same way as you would a
you would.
Chicken?
You would. Okay. The only thing sometimes can happen because it has more egg white and they're bigger is you may, like, if you hard boil them, watch, like, 1 minute less, something
uh-huh.
like that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, and it's mm-hmm. it's a good People right. say it's amazing. What
and ducks know? Are funny too. They're yeah. hilarious.
Right. They're the comedians of the barnyard.
That's why you have Donald Duck and Daffy Duck. Yeah. Nobody laughs at a chicken. Chickens aren't funny. You don't know any famous chickens. Right?